We're going bigger! Let's yes. go!
Today's topic is levitation, and we're gonna use it to make this water bottle soar through the air. Wait a second, how will you make an object fly? All we have to do is overcome the weight, the force pushing down. That's mass times gravity. If we can get a force to push up that's greater than its weight, then this object will soar through the air. And if you can get them to be balanced, then you have levitation. So today, I've got YouTube sensations, Collins and Devan Key on the show, and we're actually gonna show you how you can take this impossible topic and make it a reality. Welcome to Impossible Science. Hey everyone, it's Jason Latimer, world champion of magic, and today's secret ingredients, liquid nitrogen and Newton's third law of motion. Oh, wait, what is Newton's third law of motion? Imagine a frictionless environment, like two friends playing around on an ice rink. If one of them snuck up behind the other and decided to push them from behind, guess what happens? The one being pushed does slide forward, but the one who did the pushing from behind also starts sliding backwards. This is Newton's third law of motion in action. If object A exerts a force on object B, then object B also exerts an equal and opposite force on object A. In this case, the equal and opposite force is what causes object A to slide backwards on the ice. See, every action has an equal and opposite reaction. Now that we understand what Newton's third law of motion is, let's see the science in action. Armed with some liquid nitrogen and some water bottles and the kind city of Thousand Oaks for shutting down the fairgrounds for us, we decided to take this experiment outside because even though we knew they were gonna fly, we had no idea where they were gonna land.
We're super excited to be here today. We heard that we're like launching some bottles and just yes. making things disappear.
Side.
Whoa! Wow. You probably have a few questions, so let me explain what's going on. Liquid nitrogen has a boiling point of minus 320 degrees Fahrenheit. That's right, it's transforming from a liquid to a gas at minus 320 degrees Fahrenheit. So at room temperature or outside, it's rapidly expanding to a gas. It's also less dense than water. So when I added this to this bottle, it was sitting on top, rapidly transforming to gas, which is not a problem because the gas was escaping through the top. I'm gonna cap this just to show you what happens. When I flipped the bottle over, because it was less dense, the liquid nitrogen rose to the top of this water, but it was still rapidly transforming to gas. That gas expanded, forcing the water down. By pushing the water down, the water bottle and its contents were pushed up with Newton's third law of motion. And then you have a liquid nitrogen water rocket.
Okay, we're good. Ready?
Yep.
3, 2, 1.
Woo!
Best yet. We're going bigger?
We're going bigger.
We're going bigger! Let's
yes.
Well, that's it for today. I hope you enjoyed taking an impossible topic of a water bottle floating in the air and making it possible through science. And if you did, let me know. Click the like button and share this video with your friends. And if you want to learn about more of our goofy experiments, then make sure you subscribe to the channel and hit that notifications button. And until next time, stay curious, because the right question changes everything.
Watermelon doesn't stand a chance. This is the switch of power right here, man. I switched this thing, that watermelon's gone.
Whatever you do today, don't blink. Today's episode is about teleportation. Or what I like to call high-speed travel. Now, if you don't want to trust your eyes, that's okay, because I have special guests, Kolinsky and Devan Key from YouTube, coming on the show, and we're going to use this vacuum pump, the air around us, and a little bit of air pressure to get a ball moving so fast you won't want to believe your eyes. Welcome to Impossible Science. Hey everyone, it's Jason Latimer, world champion of magic, coming to you with another impossible science. Now today's topic is teleportation, or high speed travel. And even though we haven't been able to create teleportation through science just yet, that doesn't mean we can't get a ball moving so fast you can't even see it. So today, I thought it'd be really fun to talk about
a vacuum.
A vacuum, it's a space that has no matter or air molecules in it, like space. Or think of any container in your house. If you open it up, even though there's nothing in there, there's air molecules still in there. Even if I cap it, there's air molecules still in there. The only way to get them out is to use a vacuum pump, make sure it's perfectly sealed, and suck the air molecules out of there. So instead of building a vacuum chamber out of a bell jar, I'm gonna build a vacuum chamber out of this 8-foot PVC pipe.
We're here with Konski and Demke.
What's up?
If you guys haven't seen their experiments on YouTube, you gotta check them out. It's just amazing
Not
stuff.
Quite as scientific as his, but they can get a little bit crazy as well.
Well, this is vacuum / cannon. What?
Which that's not, like, we have vacuums at home, but ours do not actually blast ping pong balls at a high velocity.
I can't wait for this. If everything goes correctly, this ping pong ball will vanish from one side and appear in another.
Oh! What?
Go ahead, we're gonna load up the cannon.
So I'm gonna get to do it?
Yeah.
All okay, right. Cool. So we're gonna place ping pong ball in here like that.
Right, we're gonna push it down so that we can see it. Now what I'm doing here is we're gonna put a piece of Mylar on the side. And now I've capped both sides of this PVC pipe with Mylar.
Yep.
And what we're gonna do is I'm gonna screw this on so we get this nice and as close to airtight as possible.
Exactly, yes.
All right, so what's gonna happen is the faster you go, the more Mother Nature tries to prevent you from going that fast.
Yep.
By putting her hand on your forehead. The air resistance, right? So what we're gonna do is we're gonna suck all the air out of this. What you don't notice is that there's all this air above us pushing down on us right now. So when we pop that side, all this air is gonna rush in through here and launch it out that side.
Okay.
If everything goes as planned. All right,
so sounds good.
Let's vacuum the air out.
All right.
So you can see the indention here. Why don't you check it out? There's an indention. That's the suction that's going on.
Whoa.
It's happening on both sides, all right?
Yep.
Let's turn off the vacuum. Disconnect it here. All right, so this is a vacuum chamber. All you have to do is pop that.
Is it gonna be loud?
Yeah. Yeah, you just have to, your job is to watch the ball go from that end to that end. Okay. Ready?
All right, you ready? Three.
One, two, three.
Jeez!
Whoa, dude!
Without knowing the drag, friction, or how effective our vacuum cannon was, it's possible that the ping pong ball went supersonic.
That was one of the coolest sounds ever, by the way. You should like sell it as like a sound effect.
Like did you see it go?
Yeah, I saw it like here, and I saw it as end over there.
I figure, why don't we weight the ball? Then it would go a lot slower, but then it has more mass, and it could
maybe explode a watermelon?
Maybe explode a watermelon.
Yeah,
right, let's do it.
I decided to add some air pressure behind it.
Yes.
So we've got a canister choo-choo, then we're gonna add 100 PSI behind it, and then we're gonna take the air out of here, and we're gonna attack the watermelon.
Love it. All watermelon right, doesn't stand a chance. This is the switch of power right here, man. I switch this thing, that watermelon's gone.
Okay, here we go. 3, 2, 1.
Oh! Holy cow! Dude, nicely done. Oh my gosh! Literally blew the
one for science.
Pieces. Holy cow! Look at that.
Thank you. I knew that would work.
Yeah.
What we don't notice is that all around us are air molecules. They're outside and even inside this clear tube. When we placed a ping pong ball inside the tube and capped both sides with a thin membrane, we used a vacuum pump to remove the air molecules inside this chamber, creating a vacuum. And although there was very few air molecules inside this chamber, there was still all of our atmosphere outside of the chamber. So as soon as we punctured the membrane on one side, our atmosphere rushed into this pipe, picking up the ping pong ball as it surfed on a shockwave of air molecules rushing in, sending our ping pong ball faster than we could see out the other side. Teleportation? No. How about just high-speed science? Well, that's it for today. I hope you enjoyed my goofy experiment of high-speed travel and making a ping pong ball literally obliterate a watermelon. And until next time, stay curious, because the right question changes everything. We're gonna go launch a ping pong ball faster than the blink of an eye.
Three, two, one, go for it! Whoa!
Today, we're using gummy bears in chemistry. And you're probably wondering, why am I so excited? That's because we're gonna be talking about the topic of solid through solid. Welcome to Impossible Science. Hey everyone, it's Jason Latimer, world champion of magic, coming to you with another Impossible Science, the show where we take impossible topics and we see if we can actually bring them to life somehow through science. Now, unfortunately, what you just saw with the gummy bears passing through the bottom of the flask, that is actually a trick, but that doesn't change the subject. Can we actually get gummy bears to pass through another object? And it turns out, it's not gonna be any object. It's gonna be a plate of metal. Okay, before we can get gummy bears to pass through a sheet of metal, I want to go over a couple things. An endothermic process is something that requires energy to happen, usually in the form of heat. So you can think of it as ice melting into water. It requires heat in order for it to take place. Now, an exothermic process is something that gives off energy or heat. It's the exact opposite. So you can think of it as water giving off heat in order to turn into ice cubes. Now, why is that important? Because today we're gonna be using potassium chlorate. Now, this is a chemical you should not be finding at your house, by the way. This is not an at-home experiment. What happens is, if I add heat to this at roughly 673 degrees, that's the melting point for potassium chlorate, and it will actually decompose and give off oxygen, making this an example of an endothermic reaction. If I get a sufficient amount of oxygen, I can use that oxygen to react with the sugar that's in gummy bears. Now, none of us have actually seen gummy bears spontaneously ignite. That's because it's not the right percentage of oxygen in the atmosphere, nor is it the right temperature. But if I had enough oxygen and I had a high enough temperature, boom, the sugars in these gummy bears will spontaneously ignite. This endothermic reaction requires energy to decompose the potassium chlorate to give off oxygen. Now, with the elevated oxygen content, it will cause more gummy bears to melt, releasing more heat in this exothermic reaction. So you can imagine that if this was hot, gives us oxygen, this melts, gets hotter, which then gives off more oxygen, which then burns more sugar. You can understand why this could be a very violent reaction. So I looked up different melting points and found that zinc has a melting point of 787 degrees. That means it's only about 110 degrees different than the melting point from this. And I figured if we could get enough sugar and enough potassium chlorate together with enough heat, we should be able to just get these gummy bears to pass right through a solid object. So I did like all my experiments and I just contacted the Ventura County Fire Department and told them what I was gonna do so I could find a safe place to do this. And then the second thing I did was contacted Collins Key and Devan Key and said, you're not gonna believe this. I'm gonna be able to take gummy bears and we're gonna get them to cut a piece of metal.
What's up?
If you guys haven't checked out their experiments on YouTube, they do crazy stuff.
Yeah, but this is, I think, the most ludicrous thing I've ever heard. We're gonna be melting a piece of metal with a flipping gummy bear.
Yeah, what is going on?
How is that even possible?
Well, we're gonna take the sugar as fuel. This potassium chlorate, and when it gets heated up, we're gonna release some oxygen. With the heat and the fuel, we're gonna have a flame. Now, I searched all over the internet to find out the temperature of this thing.
I actually did the searching myself, and it's very hot. That's the scientific term. It's very hot.
But my guess is that it's hot enough to melt this piece of zinc.
I'm so ready. Wait, why is there a little indent in the zinc?
Okay, so when this gets heated up, it's gonna turn to a liquid.
Okay.
So rather than if we need to concentrate the potassium chlorate, when it's heated, potassium chloride, it's in the puddle. Then your job is to throw those in there.
All right, I'm ready.
I thought Jason was gonna say he got mad and just punched it one day, but I think that's a better explanation.
Headbutted.
Don't make me angry.
Do not try this at home.
No. Nope.
We have our safety goggles, we have our safety gloves, and we have the permission from the fire department.
Yep.
Oh yeah.
All right, here we go.
Yeah, I'm not knowing what's mixed with fire.
All right, so let's get it going.
Yep, and then kind of around the edge of you said?
Yeah. Once it has to heat up to about, I think potassium chlorate is about 670 degrees, right around there, it will start to melt. So we have a lot to get through. I'll just get tilted on the side here.
Okay.
So when you're dealing with a fire, you need oxygen, you need heat, and you need fuel.
Gummy bears, in this case, are the fuel.
Okay, here we go. Now we're gonna pour this into a puddle here.
Holy cow. And it's crazy, like a moment ago, it was literally just powder, and now it's this boiling substance.
All right.
Blow my mind.
Go for it. Bear time.
All right, here we go, ready? Three, two, one, go for it. Whoa!
Whoa. No
Holy
way!
Cow.
Whoa!
So here's
the thing.
Yeah,
it looks crazy!
Whoa!
See if we can concentrate the heat low. I need to get the heat to go.
And of course,
like
the moment the gummy bears goes in, the wind picks up too.
Yeah, right?
That looks bananas.
This looks awesome!
Holy cow!
It's at night!
No way!
No way!
Yo!
Yes! A gummy bear just did that.
That is insane.
Wow.
Wow.
You know, to be honest, I can't see the gummy bear anymore. It's kind of burnt, but that's
crazy. Yeah, unrecognizable. So
it reduced it to carbon, oxygen, and water, actually, is in there. I wouldn't drink it, though.
Oh, no. Definitely delicious.
There you have it. Gummy bears can actually cut through a sheet of metal. It's just wild. We really did get a gummy bear to cut through another object. Now, it didn't look like a gummy bear at the end of that, that's for sure. But we were able to make something impossible take place through science. And if you enjoy that idea of making the impossible possible through science, let me know. Click the like button, share the video with your friends, and make sure you let me know in the comments below if you're having fun with these goofy experiments. And until next time, stay curious, because the right question changes everything.
All right, so now's my turn, right?
Yeah, you're heating this up. Oh, yeah. We should probably mention the safety.
Yeah.
Do not try this at home.
Yep.